Hello, family. With all that is happening in the world, we wanted to take a little bit of time and talk about this coronavirus and just to encourage you not to operate in fear, but to operate in faith. As you stand in faith, I just want to remind you to practice good hygiene, both personal as well as communal.
Here's what we're doing at Victory. We continue to pray and intercede for all of our members, our nation, and people around the world that this coronavirus is affecting. And we'll continue to bring you information, pertinent information about what's going on concerning it so that you'll be aware. I know many of you are listening and you're hearing on the news as well, but we'll try to keep you updated. But we're still believing God that, you know, it will not affect any of us, but we're concerned about our families and our communities at large. And also what we continue to do, we use as a practice, is to disinfect all of our high trafficking areas with throughout the ministry using chemicals and cleaning products that will keep us disinfected. And, you know, we have some suggestions of things that you can do as well.
Now, according to the CDC, they're telling us to wash your hands and to wash your hands multiple times a day. Also, you can use hand sanitizers. That's really good as well. I just want to remind you that if you have to cough, you should probably cough with a napkin, a handkerchief, tissue, and if you don't have one, just make sure you cough within your arm like that maybe. And also remember, people may be a little bit uneasy with touching or being around people. I saw that in the airplane. And so you might be a person who likes to hug and shake hands. Maybe no one wants to hug and shake hands with you now. So don't be offended about it. Okay, just allow them to have that space. And you just continue to do the things that you need to do. And also, last, check on those elderly people that are in our churches just to make sure that they're doing well.
We want to encourage you all to continue to pray and to declare the word of God daily over your life and over your family and over our church family. We want you to continue to use the power and the authority that God has given us in his word to resist the devil and command that devil to stand down. You know, God has given us power and authority in his word for us to declare out loud what God has already provided for us. Don't you ever forget what God has already provided for you. You know, we've been declaring the 91st Psalm over our campuses, and I just want to read it to you today in the easy reading version. And it declares that you can go to God Most High to hide. You can go to God All-Powerful for protection. I say of the Lord, you are my place of safety, my fortress, my God, I trust in you. God will save you from hidden dangers and from deadly diseases. You can go to him for protection. He will cover you like a bird spreading its wings over its babies. You can trust him to surround and protect you like a shield. You will have nothing to fear at night and no need to be afraid of enemies' arrows during the day. You will have no fear of diseases that come to you in the dark or terrible sufferings that come at noon. 1,000 people may fall dead at your side and 10,000 right beside you, but nothing bad will happen to you. All you have to do is watch, and you will see that the wicked are punished. You trust in the Lord for protection. You have made the God Most High your place of safety, so nothing bad will happen to you. No diseases will come near your home. He will command his angels to protect you wherever you go. Their hands will catch you so that you will not hit your foot on a rock. You will have power to trample on lions and poisonous snakes. The Lord says, if someone trusts me, I will save them. I will protect my followers who call to me for help. When my followers call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them when they're in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them. I will give my followers long life and show them my power to save. Praise God.
Amen. Isn't that exciting? You know, I think the last thing that we simply need to do is just make our declaration of faith.
Yes.
If you would say this after me, 2020.
2020
is my year of freedom.
Is my year of freedom.
I decree and declare. There will be no bad news.
There will be no bad news.
In my house.
In my house.
I decree and declare. I will not die. Before my time. I will live. And declare.
The works of God.
In the land of the living. This is my greatest year. Oh, now rejoice.
Hallelujah.
And be glad.
Hallelujah. Pastor Tony and I love you all so, so very much. And we just want to make sure that you guys stand in faith, not in fear, not be moved by the things that you're here, but be people of prayer. Because when we all come together in prayer, there's some supernatural things that are going to take place in our lives. And always remember,
as Jesus is, so are we in this world. Can't kill Jesus, so it can't kill you. Freedom. We must now come to the realization that the physical senses are what holding us back from living the life that God came to give us, which is to be free. We know how to recognize what we are sensing in the natural. We recognize sickness. We recognize disease. We recognize hurt and offenses. We recognize problems. When will the church recognize what Jesus has done? I like what the singer said. He healed my body. He saved me just in time. And I want to what? Praise his name. It ought to make you want to run. It ought to make you want to shout. It ought to make you want to praise. Woo! Glory. It ought to make a sound. Woo! It ought to cause you to want to dance. Because he's already done it. Now, I want you to give God a shout of praise, and I don't know what's going on in your life, but God is still a good God. Woo! Woo! Glow! Woo! All right. Do you know what? We got to know how to shout right Woo! In the middle when things are not working. We got to know how to give God the praise. Hey! Hey! Woo! You are still alive. Your heart's still beating. You can still sense his presence. My God, it doesn't matter what hell is happening in the government, what hell is happening on the planet. God is still a good God. God still loves me. And I'm gonna lift my voice. I'm gonna dance before my God. I'm gonna give him a praise. Woo! Glow! Hallelujah. You know, there are times, man, you have to leave you at home. Do you understand? When the devil been knocking at the door of your house, it ain't time to be cute. You need some snot, you need some tissues, you need
to cry. You need to run. You need to dance. You need to open up your mouth. You need to lift up your hands. You need to shout, go! You got, hey! Woo! Hey! Ah! Take that, devil, take that! I still love Jesus!
Welcome to Victory Christian Ministries International, a place where the Word of God and the power of God are available for you, with Apostles Tony and Cynthia Brazelton. Victory starts now.
The Spirit of the Lord is upon us, and He has anointed us to preach the gospel and to raise up a body of believers to be the church of our Lord Jesus Christ, a church without walls. Our goals are to teach the Word of God so that at any time you can see the Word, hear the Word, and understand the Word of God. You can be converted into that Word you see, hear, and understand. And once we are converted, we can now strengthen the brethren and as witnesses declare with boldness, as Jesus is, so are we in this world.
You know, but you, when you got focus, it doesn't, those things doesn't distract you. And so we don't want you to be distracted. We want us to be targeted into what we're believing God to do. Our fast has purpose. We're on a corporate fast. We're believing God for His kingdom expansion in every area of our lives, where your family is concerned, your marriage is concerned, your finances is concerned, every area you can think of, your singleness is concerned, every area. We want the kingdom to manifest in that area of your life. And I know that one way that God's kingdom will be seen in your life is through this area of fasting and prayer. And so we want to talk to you a little bit about this area. First of all, understanding God's kingdom. We've been declaring that His kingdom means to come into full detail of what God has for you and I as a believer. There's so much more than what we've been seeing that God wants to manifest. And so we really want to get out of the way so that God can manifest His will in our lives. We know we got to be like John. He said, I must decrease so Christ can increase in my life. And not only that, you know, with the message that we've been hearing, the revelation, I would say that we've been hearing about dying to self and now taking on the nature of who God created and made you to be is so pivotal in this time for us in this place of fasting and prayer. It allows for the greater one that's on the inside of us to take its place. We want to not, you know, get away from just seeing ourselves the way the world sees us, or the way other people sees us, or the way you've been seeing yourself with all the limitations and its shortcomings. But now knowing that there's a greater one that's on the inside of us, getting away from that little self, grabbing hold of the big self that God has for us. And I know that fasting and prayer will actually do just that. It would allow us to be very more spiritually minded. And the Bible says in Colossians chapter 1, chapter 3, we ought to set our affections on things above and not things of the earth. And so one of the ways that we can set our affections on things above and be more, I would say, spiritually minded is through fasting and through prayer. If you fast and pray the way God says, we'll see more results of what God intended for us to get in that time of fasting and prayer than we've ever seen before. You know, there are a lot of things that the Word of God teaches us concerning this area, but it's I believe that a lot of Christians have gotten away from. I'm not gonna ask how many of you fast and pray when it's not January, but there's a time that God will call you to humble yourself. The Bible also calls it a time where we afflict our souls, that we humble ourselves before God and allow God, His word and what He has for us to exalt us in a due season. And after we have humbled ourselves before God, to humble yourself means that knowing that I am nothing without God, that I can't do it on my own, that I can't do anything without God directing me, God speaking to me, God showing me, God being there for me, and humbling myself under God's hand to do it His way. Hallelujah. Amen. Are y'all enjoying the fast? Yes. Praise God. So let's just open your Bible to Matthew chapter 6, and we'll start there.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Matthew 6. I'm sorry. Are you there? Say amen. Amen. Verse 5. And He says that when you pray, somebody say, when you pray. not if you pray, but when you pray. He says, when you pray, he's given us some instructions about prayer. He said, when you pray, he says, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray, standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. So now Jesus is introducing them, the disciples, and teaching them, spending the time with them. And it's always a blessing. Jesus takes his time to teach his, specifically his disciples. And he talks about them, about when they pray, not if they pray, but when they pray. Prayer ought to be the lifestyle of every believer. I believe Pastor Tony has said it many times, a prayerless person is a powerless person. If you want to see the power of God in your life, you want to see the supernatural in your life, you want to see kingdom expanded in your life, be a person of prayer. And so he starts off by talking about when you pray, he's telling you how not to pray. And so when he tells you how not to pray, then he begins to tell them how to pray. But he says, when you pray, don't be like hypocrites. He said, because they pray just to be seen of men. And if they pray just to be seen, they have their reward. And so we don't pray just to be seen of men. We want to be seen of God. Hallelujah. And I tell you, when you enter in that place with God in that time of prayer, everybody will know that you've been in the presence of Almighty God. And so you don't have to breathe prayer or cause prayer to be showy. It's just to be seen of God and not necessarily men. We want our rewards to come from God and not of men. And verse 60 says, but thou, when you pray, enter into your closet, and when you shut the door, somebody said, shut the door. He says, you enter into your closet. He calls that closet a secret place. When you enter into your closet, you shut the door. In other words, you shut out any and everything that would distract you from your time spending with God. It is so important that you don't allow distractions to come in and stop your time of prayer. How many ever went into a secret place or that closet place and the other phone rang or something happened and it distracts you? He says, you got to shut the door, shut things all out. In other words, you got to turn your phone off. Or do whatever is necessary. Anything that you know that would be a distraction, you have to shut it out of your life. And he says, and pray to the Father. Who are we talking to?
Father.
He's God, our Father. He says, talk to the Father which is in secret. And your Father which sees you in secret will reward you openly. Now, he's already talked about two rewards already. He said, if you praying just to be seen of men, that is your reward. But then there's another reward that comes from God, our Father, and the Father who is in secret. I mean, oh, God's in that secret place. Psalms 91 says that he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High remains and abides under the shadow of the Almighty God. That secret place is being in the presence of Almighty God. And every time you posture yourself or humble yourself to get into God's presence, you enter into a secret place. And he said, in being in that secret place, there are rewards. For the Father who sees you in secret will reward you openly or reward you publicly, or everybody will know that you've been in the presence of God, or everybody know that you have a prayer life that you ain't bragging about, but they can see it in your life. Hallelujah. Y'all feeling me? And so everybody has to establish, I believe, should establish a secret place for your life. And I'm not talking, it's not always yes, it could be a physical secret place, but it's just that time or those days or those moments that you know that you get away to be with God. And everybody ought to have that. That it's automatic that God knows that when you posture yourself in that way, that you're about to have a conversation with God. And it's not, you know, prayer is not just you talking to God, but it's you listening and hearing what God has to say to you. And it's nothing like hearing the voice of God and then obeying what God has to say to us. And then he goes on to say, but he tells them how not to pray, but then he tells you when you pray, verse 7, but when you pray, again, not if you pray, but when you pray. When you pray, use not vain repetition as the heathens do, for they think they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not therefore like unto them, for your Father knows that the things that you have need of before you ask. And this is so good to me because he says, listen, it's not your repeated over and over and over again that gets God's attention. It is what's really in your heart. And he said, the Father already knows that you have need. And he said, you know, couple this with Luke chapter 12. He says, listen, the Father already knows that you have need of things. I believe it's verse 32. He said, but I want you to do what? Seek the kingdom and its righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. So in your time of prayer, you seek it and you going in the kingdom of heaven. You're going to be with the Father and knowing that the Father already knows that I have need of things, so I don't have to go in there and repeat and ask God for the same thing over and over and over again. He already knows that I have need of those things. Hallelujah. Amen. We just spend our time communing with God. And a matter of fact, he goes on to give us the skeleton of how our prayer and what our prayer life should look like when we go before God. Verse 9, he says, after this manner, therefore, pray. He says, this is the after the manner in which you and I ought to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We acknowledge him as our Father. We acknowledge him as God. We acknowledge him for who he is in our lives and all that it comes inside of your spirit when you think about the goodness of God. When you just think about who he is in your life and what he's done for you, you can hollow the name. God, I thank you that you're my healer. I thank you that you're my provider. I thank you that you're my way maker. I thank you for what you've done today. I thank you because of this and what you've done in my life. And you reverence the presence of God in your life. He says you ought to acknowledge God when you come into his presence. Hallelujah. And then verse 10, he says you ought to pray his kingdom come. That word come means to expand. It means to grow. Hallelujah. Isn't it good that we're fasting and praying at this time, causing the kingdom of God to expand and to grow on the inside of us? He says, pray your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I like the way you've been saying it, Pastor Tony. The kingdom of God has come. It is coming. Hallelujah. And it's yet to come. Amen. Because there is so much more that we haven't seen, that God is expanding. Again, 2 Corinthians 2 says, your eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. It has not entered the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those that love him. And so there is a greater, there's a bigger on the inside of us that God is preparing for us. And so we've got to die to that little self and take on the nature of who our God is and declare his kingdom come, his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. He says, go on, and he says, declare, give us this day our daily bread. And this encompasses God, bringing before God those things that you need on a daily basis. And God, listen to me, God already knows what you have need of. And just think about it when he says, give us this day our daily bread. You know, bread represents the word of God. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. God, give me wisdom for this day. Give me revelation for this day. Give me a word that will take me through this day. Give me this day my daily bread. Hallelujah. And then today's provisions. How many know that God daily loads us with benefits? Praise God. What benefits does God have for you today that you missed out on because you simply didn't ask? Give us this day our daily bread. And how many know the healing is the children's bread? Praise you, Jesus. And so just looking at what God has provided for us, thanking God that you can walk in divine health. If the enemy is attacking your body anyway, God, give me this day my provisions for health and healing to walk in divine health this day of my life. Amen. Then he says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. You know, when you look at the Lord's Prayer and all that God is in, the manner in which we ought to pray, it encompasses and surrounds all your life so that there will be nothing that will hinder you from walking in God's perfect will for your life. And there's nothing that will hinder the expansion of God's kingdom in your life. And here's one of the ways that, you know, you and I could really miss out on what God has for us in his kingdom if you walk in unforgiveness. You know, you believe in God to do something in your life, but yet you have unforgiveness or you're holding something against someone, you got to let it go. Tell your neighbor, say, let it go.
Let it go.
Say, forgive.
Forgive.
You know, when you don't forgive, that is a product of your little self. But when you realize that you are bigger than that, and it doesn't matter if somebody's offended you or somebody said something bad of you, you know you're bigger than that, you can easily forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And so he says, God, release me of any
wrongs doing that I've done as I release others that have wronged me in any kind of way. And really, we are really positioning ourselves to walk in that big self who God made you to be and see that manifest in your life. Verse 13, again, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, or deliver us from the evil one. And so, you know, all temptation comes to us, James tells us, because of the own lust of our own selves. Again, temptation comes because of that little self. But when you recognize the big self that's in you, this is so good to me. It allows you not to even fall. Even when you are tempted, you know that God has already provided a way of escape. You're not giving in to your little self. You're letting the big self take you charge of your life and leading you out into that place where you are escaping that temptation that is in your life. And one thing about being tempted, when you follow the leading of the Holy Ghost, you're going to come out under the power of the Spirit of God in your life like never before. There's going to be a release of more power in your life. One of the things is you understand that there's power that's being released on the inside of me when I don't give in to the temptation. It takes power to not to give in to the temptation. And when you don't give in to it and you follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, there's a greater power that is released in your life. The Bible says Jesus was tempted in the wilderness with the enemy for 40 days. And how many know he overcame through the word of God? Matthew chapter 4 and Luke chapter 4, he overcame with the word of God. And then the Bible said he came out in the power of the Spirit of God. Yeah. Hallelujah. I believe at the end of January, we're going to come out on the power of the Spirit of God. We're going to see a greater outpouring of God's Spirit than we've ever seen before. So don't give in to the temptation of chicken. Y'all thought I was talking about something else. He says, well, I'm not tempted by drugs. I'm not tempted by sex. I'm not tempted by all that stuff. You're tempted by chicken and a piece of cake and a donut. Somebody said, don't give in.
Don't give in to the donut.
Hallelujah. You know how it is, that nice person on your job bring donuts every morning and sit them out on the table in the break room for everybody to have. And you go in the break room and you smell them. You're putting yourself in a position. You're being drawn by your own lust. Don't give in. Remember, we have purpose for our fasting. We have purpose. The kingdom of God is expanding on the inside of you. And I will not lose my birthright for a donut. I will not lose my birthright for a piece of chicken. I will not give up what God's doing on the inside of me.
Jesus.
Are you hearing me? And so he says, lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from the evil one. Why? For thine is the kingdom. Glory to God. For thine is the kingdom and the glory and the power forever. Wow. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
Because it's his kingdom. It's his power and his glory that will be seen. We're going to see more of the supernatural. And I believe, and I'm praying, and we're believing God for more manifestations of That's the right. supernatural of his kingdom, because we've given ourselves over to fasting and prayer. And listen to me, the times that you would use in just pigging out on certain things, use that as a time to get a word of God and chew on it. Get a word for your life. Get a word that God is speaking to you concerning your family, and just meditate on that word. Spend time in the word of God in this area of prayer. And so he said, after this manner, we ought to pray. And then he says, verse 15, but if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you of your trespasses. Again, we've already declared we're going to let some things go. Somebody said, let it go.
Let it go.
Said 2019
is
my year of kingdom expansion.
Is my year of kingdom expansion.
Glory to God. He says, verse 16, he says, moreover. Somebody said, moreover.
Moreover.
Now, we spend a lot of time sometimes in prayer, but here's an area where we don't add to the prayer life so that it can be a release of more power. There is power in your time of prayer, but there's a greater to be seen. And there's a greater that you and I can enter into to see a greater manifestation. Or I would say no more delay in your prayer time or manifestations of what you're believing God in. And this is this area of moreover.
Wow.
He says, moreover, in addition to your praying, you ought to fast. He says, when you fast, not if you fast. Fasting ought to be the lifestyle of every believer. It ought to be something we do on a regular basis, not just January. And God will sometimes speak to you when you're fasting and praying and you need answers. How many need answers to questions? And sometimes, you know, I don't believe that for any moment that God is withholding anything back from us. We're just not in a position to hear what he's saying to us. And so if we would just deny your flesh, deny your body, its right to control your life, but now yield yourself to the Spirit of God. And how you do that is through humbling yourself and through fasting and prayer. And so you fast before God, denying your body what it's craving and its desire, and so that you can hear from God. Fasting never moves God. It moves you out of the way. It would always move you. And if you are in the way, and sometimes you don't even know you're in the way, fast. Because the moment you start to fast, you'll see how much you really are in the way. Because you make up, you say, nobody called to fast. You decided, or the Spirit of God inside of you said, I think we ought to fast today. Because nobody else knew it but you. Before the end of the day, you eating something because you only made a promise to you. And nobody else knew it. And so you realize that your body has more control over you than you. And that's the time where you ought to, the Bible says, I would say, mortify the deeds of your body. Kill those appetites that is causing you not to position yourself to hear from God. Mm-hmm. I heard this man give a testimony, but, you know, I believe it's my testimony, too, because it's happened to me. And I believe if you're really a man and woman of God of fasting and prayer, I'm sure all of you have experienced this as well. He said he was fasting, but I'm saying this because he said he fasted for the very first time. And he said it was so hard for him because everywhere he went, he smelled food. Never smelled it before, but because I'm fasting, he smelled food everywhere he went. And he said it was so hard. I mean, stomach growling, head hurting, tongue stuck to the roof of your mouth. I mean, just going through, and his body was screaming, eat, eat, eat. And he says, I refuse to allow my body to dictate to me what I do in life. And he said, so I spoke to my body and I spoke to this area of my life. And I said, because you acted a fool today, we're going to fast again tomorrow. Hallelujah.
All right.
And we're going to keep fasting till you get, till you realize who's really in charge. You are not the one controlling me. I'm controlling you. And you think you're hurting today, you're going to hurt again tomorrow. How many ever been there? Hallelujah. And so you got to know. You think you're in control. You think you can do what you want to do. You think, you know, yeah, I'm doing this. But when you're fasting and nobody else knows it, he said, that's the time you ought to really gain control over this body and really see where you really are. I think everybody's been there. If you're really serious about fasting before the Lord, everybody comes to that place in their lives sometimes. Where you have, your body is challenging, this area of your soul is challenging you. It says, moreover, verse 16, moreover, when you fast, not if you fast, be not as hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces, that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily I say unto thee, they have their reward. Again, you see the reward system in fasting and prayer. He says, if you walking around with your face hanging down and you go to your work, it's like, hey, what's wrong with you? Well, church is fasting. I can't eat. Don't you have? No, I can't have none of that. He said, if that's what you want people to see you like that, he says, that is your reward. Wow. You ought to go on your job with your face lifted up and you're in a smile. They offer you a piece of chicken, say, no, thank you. Hallelujah. They offer you a donut, say, no, I don't want it. No, thank you. What you mean you don't want no? Girl, you always eat donuts. I don't want no donuts. Donuts ain't controlling me. Hallelujah. Y'all too quiet in here with that one. Somebody said, don't look sad.
Don't look sad.
Say, be happy.
Be happy.
He said, but when you fast, here he's saying, when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face. That you may appear not to men to fast. Again, you ought to have a big smile on your face. But unto thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which sees in secret, here's your reward again, will reward you openly or reward you publicly. God, people will know that you have been in the presence of God and you've been in that place with God in this time of fasting and praying before the God. And so fasting and prayer has great rewards to it, and God will see to it. And one of the things is the power of God, the supernatural manifesting in your life. It allows us to mortify the deeds of our body, afflict our soul, the Bible says. Afflict our souls is humbling ourselves before God, having an ear to hear from God. Let the Spirit of God lead us and lead us by our spirit, and not let our flesh dictate to us what we do and where we go in life and what we receive from God. And again, allowing that bigger self on the inside of us to take its place, and not the little self to dictate to us where we, the limitations that it put on us, we take the limitations off of our lives. Amen?
Amen. I like to say fasting is an act of your will. You must willfully, I believe, put your body under subjection. And fasting is a personal commitment to renounce the natural, to invoke the supernatural. We talk about wanting to get involved with this world that God's called, which is his kingdom. And it's here, but the only biggest problem for us walking in the spirit or walking in the supernatural is really our bellies. And so when you start to fast, that's what you are renouncing the flesh, but you are invoking the spirit. And it's important to realize fasting is when we seek God. Fasting is not just missing a meal, because you can miss a meal and you're really not really seeking God. You're just so busy. So fasting is more than just missing a meal. In other words, we're going to replace our time that we would use to cook our food. For example, you know, you think about how long does it take to make food? You got to go to the store, you got to shop for it. You got to bring it home, and you either got to put it in the microwave or something. That takes time. But whatever time that you would use to feed yourself, then you use that time to seek God. So that's what it means. You take the time that now all of a sudden, what fasting does for you, it gives you back your time. Then the question is, what will you do with that time? And that's when you begin to seek God. So fasting is like hooking yourself up to this huge tank. You know, fasting breaks habits. We have the testimonies every year of people, my God, I used to do this. I used to be hooked on this, and then they fasted, they're no longer hooked on it. I was taking these number of medicines, and I'm no longer have to take those medicines. So fasting breaks habits. It expands your spiritual capacity. And that's important to God, because he's always trying to increase you. He's trying to enlarge you. That's what we're talking about, this kingdom. Expansion. And fasting will position you to expand that kingdom, because one of the greatest hindrance to expanding where this kingdom is concerned is what's going on in the natural. Being so moved by what we see, moved by emotions and our feelings. And so a lot of times we're making so many decisions based on our emotions. It has nothing to do with the kingdom. And so we've got to learn how to get our emotions under our authority, because the real you is not physical. The real you is spiritual, and trying to get your spiritual world, your feelings and your emotions and your thought lights to come in line with what God wants to do in this hour. And so to do that is that we've got to almost shrink this flesh, and we've all so that we can open up to receive what God has for us spiritually. And so fasting quiets the body. That's what she was saying there. You know, the body is always talking, always got something going on. And sometimes you know how important it is to quiet the body. Fasting brings godly intimacy in. You know, you really start, when you start fasting, you're going to see God. So it brings intimacy to the table. You know, you start to love his presence. You start to go back to those things that you used to do, that all of a sudden life begin to hit you with all these things that you're no longer doing anymore. But fasting gives you that time back so that you can, you know, spend time with godly intimacy. So fasting is so important. It just helps us to realize, you know, if we're going to carry the weight of what God's calling us to do, the only reason that you and I will be able to carry the capacity of it is our ability to fast. Listen to me, everything that you're doing, you know, fasting really just puts your flesh under the authority of your spirit. Think about it. When you feed the flesh, your spirit man will be weak. And if your spirit man is weak, then the supernatural will be weak in your life. But if we feed our spirit man, then our spirit man will be strong, and then we'll be able to carry the dominion, the authority, and the power, and the glory of God in this generation. So when you talk about fasting, you're talking about walking in dominion. You're talking about walking in the power of God, walking in the authority of God. We're talking about a release of God's glory in this generation, a release of his power, a release of the supernatural. We need a release of God's provisions, and the people that can carry that reality are people who have learned to do something with a voice. See, the enemy moves through the voice of my flesh. You understand? If he can get me to realize, the devil know that, you know, you get hungry, so he starts talking through you through the voice of your flesh to rob you of the potential of walking in what God wants to do in this generation. And so when we look at the ministry of Jesus, how did Jesus' ministry begin? Jesus' ministry began through what? Fasting. Hallelujah. How will life for you and I truly begin is because we've learned the secret to what fasting does for us. And let's just look at that for a minute. In Luke chapter 3, we see Jesus is baptized in the Jordan River. In Luke 3, verses 22, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven and said, "You are my beloved son. In you I am well pleased." And then we read the next verse, which is chapter 4, verse 1. It says, "Then Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in." He was led by the Spirit. He was led by the Spirit in to the wilderness. So he was led in by the Spirit. His fasting was a result of the Holy Ghost. He hears from God, and the next thing that God said, "Now, you're my son in whom I'm well pleased." So ministry begins on the reality of us knowing who we are, not based on what the world says you are, not based on what your job is, what you can do. That's not really who you are. That's what you do. But who you are is, "This is my beloved daughter in whom I'm well pleased. This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. Now hear them." So God then begins to prepare Jesus to carry the wealth of this ministry to change a world. And he leads him. He's led into fasting. And then the Bible talks about he fasted how many? 40 days and 40 nights. So the Holy Ghost led him into fasting. He was led into fasting. 40 days and 40 nights. And then we realize the fruit of that fast came out in verse 14. I like what verse 2, it says, "And being tempted for 40 days by the devil, and in those days he ate," verse 2, "he ate nothing. And afterwards, when he had ended, he was hungry. And the devil said to him," and they begin to tempt him, "If you are the Son of God, do these things." But we know the result of him being led in, that God was going to also lead him out. And in verse 14, we see he's led out. He says, "Then Jesus returned in the power." He's led out. He's led out in the power of the Holy Ghost. See, that's what God wants to do with us in this season. He's leading us into a time of prayer. He's leading us in time of fellowship. He's leading us in a time of communion and intimacy and a walk with God so that he can lead us out in power. Woo, glory. You know, God's greatest desire, man, is for his children to walk in the dominion, to walk in his kingdom dominion, walk in his kingdom's power, walk in his kingdom's glory. And here is the way it happens. It doesn't happen without this transition. And a lot of times you're challenged on your life, but that is a transition into the life that God has for you. And how you handle it will determine whether you'll walk out in power or whether you'll walk out in the flesh. See, when you face difficult times and you come out complaining, you come out murmuring, you come out in the flesh, then your spirit man is weak.
I love it how he was saying how he was led in the spirit, by the spirit into the wilderness and to be tempted of the devil. And how you can see how fasting and prayer gives you victory over demonic influences in your life. I mean, it really gives you the power over the strongholds that may be in your life. It reminds me in Matthew 17 and Mark chapter 9 as well, when the man brings his lunatic son.
But before you go there, listen, really what fasting do is you're exercising yourself. And anytime you exercise, you have to have some form of resistance. Mm-hmm. In order to develop muscles, you need resistance.
Amen.
You go to the gym, you're not going to get any muscles. You're not going to develop. Your natural man cannot develop physically without resistance. Mm-hmm. And so God wanted to develop Jesus. So he had to send him in a place where he could experience a resistance. Fasting causes you to develop because there's a resistance. You're resisting the flesh so you can come out in the spirit. You're resisting the attitude of having an ugly attitude toward people. You're resisting that so you can come out with an attitude of God. You've got to resist everything that's physical and natural in order to come out spiritually and powerful. But in every one of those cases, God is walking with you. He's there with you. As a matter of fact, he's the coach. Come on, pick up some more weight. Come on, you can do more than that. Push one more time. And keep your mouth shut. No, I need to talk about them. No, shut your mouth. Don't talk about them. Keep your mouth shut. I know they're wrong. I know that they're crazy. I know that they're ugly. I know that they're nasty. Don't be nasty. What are you doing? I am strengthening you spiritually because there's coming a time when you open your mouth, God will hear you and the devil will hear you and everybody else will hear you. What is he doing? You're strengthening your spiritual man. So that's why fasting is necessary. And being challenged while you're in a fast is necessary. That's why when you go to work, they have never had donuts until this week. They have never had cakes until this week. Why wasn't the cakes there last month? Why? Because God is causing there to be a resistance. Now, he's not causing that, but he will use it to position you and I to be stronger men and women of God, strong enough not to be backbiting, strong enough men and women. Stop talking about people. Do you know that's not how you think the church gets mature? You know, do you realize if you have a problem and you don't ever get the victory over it, you'll see that problem everywhere you go. If you think people are after you, people are picking on you, people are always talking about you, do you know everywhere you go, you'll think, and somebody does something negative to you, you'll think it's a combination of that. Mm-hmm. Everybody that's how they treat me in here. No, one person may have treated you that way, but now you're logging all of those cases into one category. Good. Listen to me, we can't do that. That's why you've got to do something with the flesh. If you don't discipline the flesh, you're going to be weak spiritually. But if you begin to exercise your spiritual muscle, how? By disciplining the flesh, then you're going to be strong spiritually. And spiritually strong people God uses. He uses the spiritually strong. Why? Because people always misunderstand spiritually strong people. They're the most misunderstood people on the planet. Why? Because they don't act like people in the flesh. People in the flesh want you to do things in the flesh. Why you don't do it that way? Why you don't do it that way? Because I'm not led by the flesh. I'm led by the spirit.
Hallelujah.
And see, to be spiritually minded is life and peace. But to be fleshly minded is corruption. So you're trying to walk together. That's why the Bible says, how can two walk together unless they agree? You can't be spiritually minded and you be fleshly minded and have a walk. They don't work. It takes spiritually minded people to walk together, and it takes fleshly minded people to walk together. And so you'll notice fleshly minded people will collect fleshly people. Come on, did you hear what they said? Yeah. I totally agree. Two fleshly, three fleshly, four fleshly people together in agreement. You know, social media is phenomenal. I believe in it. I think God can use it greatly. But the only drawback to social media is in a negative sense, and there's a lot of positives.
to social media. I'm not putting social media down. But we've got to be aware of it. It has opened up a door where we can, before, if I was wrong about something, the relationships that I had with my friends, they were able to pull me in. Because we had relationship. But now, I don't need your approval. I don't even need to listen to you. I can have my own idea, and I can go on this social platform and find other people that are in agreement with me. And then I walk away believing that I'm okay. Do you understand? Oh, you can find a whole lot of flesh on social media, and we're not even aware of that. We're on social media just telling all our business. That's nothing but flesh. And we're okay with that. It's not all of it's flesh. Let me take that back. Not all of it. Some of it is great, but you know what I mean. Some of it is just purely flesh. You know, you over there complaining about somebody that you didn't like. I don't like that pastor over there. And? Do you understand? We have created a platform to be fleshly. And the problem with that is that your spirit man gets weaker. He gets weaker. And he gets weaker, and he gets weaker. And instead of us being people who are now can participate in the supernatural, we're instead of being participants, we find ourselves on the outside when God has called the church to carry this gospel message, the gospel of the kingdom, to a dying, hurting world. And now we're starting to look like them. And so what does fasting do? It just reverses all of that, puts us back where we believe, where we should be. Oh, I've been talking too much. Let me pull it in. It makes us realize, oh, I've been, okay, I got caught up for a minute. Yeah. And we all get caught up. You understand?
Amen.
I get caught up, all of us. It's not to put anybody down, but it's easy because the world is fleshly. And so, but this time you spend time with God. He begins to position your mouth. He begins to position your actions. He begins to position your emotions and all those things for one reason. So that you can walk in who you really are. And then you were saying what?
No, I was just saying, you know, all that what you were saying, we get in fasting, resist the devil. And what happens when you resist the devil?
He's going to flee.
Amen.
So you don't have to fuss with him, get in the flesh with him. You don't have to do that. And that's what you were about to say in Matthew 17.
Yes.
We see that. We know that this young man his father bought his son to his disciples, and his disciples couldn't do nothing for them. And we read that in Matthew 17, verse 14 through 21. It says, when he had come to the multitude, a man came to him, kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he's epileptic and suffers severely, for he often falls into the fire and often in the water. So I brought him to your disciples. Do you understand what the disciples of Jesus are supposed to do? God, we're supposed to be able to do something about that. We are disciples. So I brought him to your disciples, but they could not cure him. And then Jesus answered and says, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me. Jesus rebuked the demon and it came out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, why could we not cast it out? Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief. For as surely I say unto you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible. Nothing will be impossible for you. See, can you see the need to move away from a feeding my flesh to now feeding my spirit? Because when I feed my spirit, I'm in a position where nothing will be impossible for me. See, they ran into something that looked impossible, and he was telling them why you couldn't walk in that. And he says, and he goes on to say to them, he says, however, this kind does not come out except by how? Prayer and fasting. Jesus combined both fasting and prayer because both strengthen the spirit of a man.
Amen. Amen.
That's how you strengthen your spirit of man, when you spend time in prayer and you spend time in fasting. They wanted the supernatural. They wanted to do what Jesus had said that they had a right to walk in. But we found out why they weren't able to walk in it. Their spirit man wasn't strong enough to carry that. So he said, what do you need to do? You need to spend time fasting and praying. So what that said to me, I'm not going to change just because I want to change. I'm not going to change my position just because I have a desire to change my position. When I hear the word and what God has for me, it's not going to just happen just because I want that. There are things in my life that I have to transition over. And the only way that I can make that transition out of the flesh into the spirit, out of this place that I'm in, into what God's calling me in this season, is because I've spent the time fasting and praying. See, a lot of times in New Year, we hear a word from God and we're excited about the word. And that's God's desire for our lives. But the thing that keeps me out of his desire is my flesh, my belly, my mouth, my emotions, my attitudes. My heart wants it, but my emotions are messed up. My heart wants it, but my attitude's messed up. And so now, why am I not walking in it? Why can't I control my mouth? Why can't I control my behavior? Why can't I just love people? I want to love. God tells me to love. I confess that I'm loved. Why? My flesh is too alive. You're feeding your flesh. Starve it. Put it to sleep. Take control over it. And then all of a sudden, you're gonna notice a strength that you've never walked in, a strength, because you're going to start walking in your spirit. You're going to hear God. Man, I want to hear the voice of God. Quiet your flesh. And I want to hear him talk to me. Quiet your flesh. That's what we're fasting for. We want to transition into what God is doing in this season of in life, not what he did, you know, years ago. He did some great things, and he's still doing great things. And what he did seasons ago, wonderful, great, good. But the question is, what is he doing now? Do you realize that? I realize even when we talk about change, change is not possible without this transition. You introduce new ideas to people that have been doing the same thing forever, they automatically resist the new ideas. And they think something's wrong with you because you offer something new. Why? That was great. That was wonderful. How am I going to get there if you're struggling with that? Kill the flesh. Let your spirit man come alive. Let him be the one that's leading your discussion. Let him be the one that's communicating to you what the Father is saying. Let him be the one that is in the forefront of your life. How I'm doing that? We're taking the time to fast and to pray. You know, I like what Galatians 5, verse 17 says. It says, for the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. See, they're in opposition against each other. He says, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. That's the reason I'm not doing what I want to do. I want to do what I want to do, but there's this opposition going on in my life. It had nothing to do with any one of you. I got my own oppositions I'm dealing with. My flesh is warring against my spirit, and so this opposition is going on. So one of them has to take the lead. If I keep feeding my flesh, then my flesh will be stronger, and all of a sudden my spirit man will drop back. But if I begin to mortify the deeds of the flesh, how? Through fasting, through the discipline of fasting exercising my will to fast so that, man, my spirit man can come to the forefront. Woo. Now, when you're walking in the forefront, now you can walk by faith. Now, things that seemed impossible now becomes possible. Do you see what God is doing? He's trying to move you, like Pastor Cindy said, from the smaller reality, the smaller version of who you are, to the bigger version of who you are. This version is so much bigger than what you're living now. What you're living now is good. It's wonderful. We love it. Kiss, kiss, kiss. But it's so small compared to the version that God knows of any one of us. This version is as Jesus is. So are we in this world. This version raises the dead. This version casts out devil. This version, glory, can love its own enemies. This version can walk on water. This version heals the sick. This version is not moved by man. This version is moved by God. This version hears from God. This version has a relationship with God. This version has a relationship with food. And loves it. I like sweets. My version here is we want sugar. And before the fast, I went looking for donuts. This version was getting taken care of. I started thinking about everything that I need to eat before the fast shows up. But that's this version. And so this version, I was trying to satisfy this version. I was feeling this version. And at the same time, this version is falling back. But I'm thinking, you can fall back a little bit because January is coming. You're going to fall back to the front.
We want to stay in the forefront, right? Yeah, yeah. We don't want to fall back. We want to keep moving forward.
I'm saying that because I don't want you to feel condemned.
Amen.
So I'm talking about me. I'm talking about me. If I talk about me, I don't want you to walk away condemned or feel like I'm saying ugly things about you. We all are dealing with this. This opposition, all the ones, every one of us is dealing with them. Mine's may be different. Mine is the sweets. Yours could be your mouth. Yours could be your emotions. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it is. Yours could be your attitude. Yours could be you have an anger issue. You're just angry all the time. You fly off the handle, no control. What yours is may not be mine, but they all are tied to the flesh. Now I can either feed that reality or discipline that one so that the real me, the bigger me, can be seen. And that's all we're talking about.
That's good. As he was saying that, you know, fasting and prayer gives you power and authority over the demonic realm or the demonic influences that may come into your life. As Jesus said, this kind only comes out but by fasting and prayer. And so if the enemy is attacking you in any area of your life and you need the victory over it, like Jesus, you can use the time in fasting and prayer. Like Jesus said to them, because he spent a lot of time in fasting and prayer, and he was telling them, hey, he was able to cast that devil out and just happen right then and there, is because he said this comes out by fasting and prayer. And how many know he was a man that fasted in prayer a lot of times? And you know, in the book of Esther, and we'll close with this, you know, Esther in her day, she was a young girl that was being raised by her uncle Mordecai, and Mordecai told Esther not to reveal herself to the king. And y'all know the story of Esther and how she was chosen to be king in the place of Vashti. And as a result of her becoming the queen, Mordecai, her uncle, said, don't tell anybody that you're a Jew. And because of that, there was a time when Haman, the king's right-hand man, didn't like Mordecai, because he was the only person that didn't bow to him when he walked down the street. And so because he hated him so much, he didn't want to just kill Mordecai. He wanted to kill all the race of people that was associated with Mordecai. He wanted to kill all the Jews. How many are familiar with the story? I feel like I'm rushing through it. But he wanted to kill all the Jews. And so he went to the king and said, make a decree. There's some people that don't believe like we believe. There's some people that don't do what we do. And we need to wipe them from the face of the earth. And the king gave him his ring, and he made a decree to kill all the Jews on a certain day. And then Mordecai heard about it. He saw the decree, and he sat in sackcloth and ashes. And There's a word that went back to Esther and said, your uncle, he's sitting in sackcloth. He's humbling himself before God. And she's like, what's going on? He said, there's a decree that on a certain day that everybody can kill all the Jews and take all their possessions. And so she sends clothes to him. He said, I'm not going to put clothes on. He said, you need to go and intercede for us. You need to pray to the king in our behalf. And so she said, I can't go to the king. If he doesn't call you, you can't go. And he says, listen to me. You don't know if God brought you into the kingdom for such a time as this. And I believe that God brought all of us into the kingdom for such a time as this. He wants his kingdom to be expanded on the inside of every single one of us. And he says, you got to do what you got to do. In other words, if you don't do what you have to do, God's going to send deliverance from somewhere else. But understand this, that God is he will deliver us all. And so, you know, her response was, you know, I'm going to see the king. She said, if I perish, let me perish. He said, but I want us to fast and pray. They fasted and prayed for 3 days. They didn't eat any food or drink anything. And in that time of fasting and prayer, they got the victory over the enemy that was coming against them. But not only that, they heard a word from God. She heard from God. What do I need to do, God? What do I do? He said, throw a party. Throw a banquet. Invite Haman and the king. She heard from God. All because she took the time not to be moved by the flesh, but be moved by the Spirit of God and what God was directing them to do. Flesh was afraid that everybody's going to die. But the Spirit of God is saying, here's what you need to do. And you know, they had that party and the king was so pleased with her. He held out his scepter. She found favor in his sight. He says, what do you want? I'll give you even up to half my kingdom. What does fasting and prayer do for you? I'll give you the kingdom. Woo! Oh my God. I'm going to give you the kingdom. Woo! Glory to God. He said, you can have half of my kingdom. She says, I want to throw a party for you and Haman. You just come. He gets there. They enjoying themselves. He says, okay, baby, what you want? She says, I want to do this again tomorrow, because she's got to build up some confidence in asking for this thing. He says, okay. In the meantime, you know, Haman is just upset at Mordecai that he builds these gallows to hang Mordecai on. And before he could, and then he realized that God is honoring Mordecai, but before he could put the gallows down, he's invited to the party. They said, come on, it's the party time. I'm making a long story short. They get to the party, and he says, okay, baby, what you want? He said, you can have up to half my kingdom. All because she prostrated herself in fasting and prayer. And what did fasting and prayer bring? It brought her deliverance from her enemies. It brought her favor with the king. Yeah. It brought her everything that the kingdom of heaven had for her. And she says, I just want my life. He said, what do you mean your life? Who is coming against you? Who's trying to take your life? What sickness, what disease, what poverty, what lack, what enemy is coming against you trying to take your life? You're the queen. You belong to me. You're in the kingdom. Who's trying to take your life? She said, that Haman. You know what happened? The king was so upset. He was so angry. He walked away. You know, he got so mad that you just had to walk away from the situation. And Haman, when the king walked out, he just fell on Esther and he just begged for his life now. And the king walks in and all he can see is Haman laying on his wife. And he said, those gallows that he made for Mordecai, hang him on it. I'm telling you, it will give you power over all demonic influences in your life. Woo! It will cause you to have the victory. You will come out in the power of the Spirit of God. And not only that, he said, the enemy that was trying to come against you to destroy you, you get to make another decree. The Bible says you shall decree a thing and it shall be a... It will be established unto you. You get to decree now. And everyone that comes against you, you get to destroy. Everybody that comes in your house, you get to go in there and destroy them and take their spoil. And he said, after all that happened, he said, are you satisfied? This is so good to me. After all of that, you destroyed your enemy. Are you satisfied? She says, no. Can we do it again tomorrow? Because I want to make sure that same devil don't come after me again. I'm going to destroy him till he is utterly destroyed. That's what fasting and prayer will do for you. And they utterly destroyed their enemies that were coming against them. And I pray that you take this time of fasting and prayer very seriously. There's so many things that are happening in the house of victory that God wants to do in and through our lives. And we don't want to position ourselves with our flesh, will deny God his right to do what he wants to do in the house of victory. Everybody has this. It's a corporate fast that we're doing, not individual. It's a corporate fast that we're coming together as a body of believers. We're building a better community. The Bible said, and as we've been saying through the word, we're bringing unity among ourselves. Somebody said, we're better together. And when we come together as a corporate body of believers and fasting, we're better together if everybody do their part. You can say, well, I'll just eat some chicken today. It ain't gonna matter. Everybody else is fasting. Everybody. You ought to have more control over your flesh than to have that. And so you have to be, it's no meats, no sweets, and no junk food. And there's plenty of other food that you could eat. Get some recipe books, get some stuff so that you can continue with the fast. I hear people say, well, you know, I'm on medication. I got to have some chicken. No, you do not have to have medication. You do not have to have chicken to take medication. You do not. I'm not even a doctor and I know better. Now, any nurses or doctors in the house? One, two. Do you have to have chicken to have medication? They all said no. So there's no excuses for all of us to participate in the fast that we have called. And we've asked everybody, if God is dealing with you in other areas of your life that you need to put down, then you choose that for yourself, whether it's social media, whether it's the television, whether it's video games, whether it's the phone, whatever it is, if God's dealing with your heart concerning something, then you ought to make that a part of your fast as well. Amen. Our time is up. Come on, stand to your feet. Did you get anything tonight? Hallelujah. There's so many examples of fasting and getting victory and the victory over the enemy. Just do a word study and just look at, the more you read about it and what's available to you, the more it will allow you to overcome the deeds of the body and the flesh and allow you to stick with your assignment. And it won't allow you to allow it to get the better of you. Amen. So if you would lift your hands high to heaven. Father, we thank you so much for the word of God that we've heard here today. Father, I pray that you would hide the word in our hearts so we will not sin against you, Lord God. Father, we thank you that you've already provided a way of escape for every temptation that we may face in life. God, it is our heart's desire is to mortify the deeds of this body and to give ourselves fully and wholly over to you and over to the Spirit of God. Holy Spirit, have your way in the house of victory. Have your way in every single one of us. We thank you, Lord God, you made provisions for every single one of us to overcome the deeds of this body and to overcome the attacks of the enemy. Father, we give ourselves to fasting and prayer, a corporate fast and prayer. And we thank you for the signs and the wonders and the miracles, the power of God that we will see as a body of believers. We have such a desire to let your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let heaven's reality invade every single one of our homes, Lord God, and every single one of our lives, all those areas where we have not gotten the victory. Let us have the victory in this time of fasting and prayer. God, we look to you to give over to us in those areas of our lives where we need victory. Shine a light on it so that we can see and know. And Father, we put this flesh under subjection to the Spirit of God to be led by your Spirit. We thank you, Lord God, for our time of fasting and prayer and seeking your face. We thank you for the kingdom that is expanding on the inside of every single one of us. We believe, Lord God, we receive from your Spirit. And everybody that will agree with me, say amen. 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 Before you are